Welcome to Environmental Fridays. This series is brought to you by Best Early, the Benton Spirit Community Newspaper, and Andrews University Community Engagement Council. GC Scored, Every Piece Matters. Introducing your host, Dr. Desmond Hartwell Murray, and this week's co-host, Jordan Rogers. This week on Environmental Fridays, we'll be hearing from Dr. Jason Claiborne.
Welcome again to Environmental Fridays. It is personal. Today we have a very special guest, as we always do. We have very special guests on Environmental Fridays, and he's here with his butterflies. You'll hear some more about that later. But before, I just always want to share with the audience who my co-host is. My co-host here is Jordan Rogers. Jordan Rogers is a senior at Mississippi School for Math and Science, and it's a public residential high school for academically gifted and talented students. So we assume that Jordan fits right in there. This MSMS is also a member of the National Consortium of Secondary STEM Schools. So there are a number of these types of schools across the country. Jordan serves as a peer tutor. She works with the Math Outreach Program and is heavily involved in the research program with Mississippi State University. How close are you to Mississippi State University, Jordan?
It's about a 30-minute drive, so it's not too far.
Okay. And what research do you do?
Currently, I'm working with Food Micro. So I'm about to start an experiment with avocados and shelf life.
Okay, very nice. So outside of school, Jordan works as an editor slash staff writer for The Vision and is a student in the IBM Quantum and MIT affiliate program, Qubit by Qubit. I don't know what that is, but the name brand sounds pretty impressive, MIT and IBM. She also has showed interest in environmental conservation and the awareness of it through multiple projects. She hopes for all people to have a greater understanding of human effects, our effects on the environment, so that further destruction can be prevented. So that's my co-host for today. Before she introduces the speaker, just to reemphasize that this Environmental Fridays is really about and was designed and intentioned for mentoring our next generation about the environment, our next generation, like persons like Jordan here. And we are looking at the environment and in terms of basic fundamental scientific reason. I believe that we have to be humble and stewards of the environment, because life as we know it would not exist. The basic understanding now about our universe is that it's based on relationship and relatedness. And so life is dependent directly on the environment, because we share energy between life forms and the environment, and we share matter. That exchange is essential for life. And so the environment is essential for us. And in fact, it is personal. And so some of the topics that we we'll be discussing for this entire year. This Environmental Fridays is every Friday for the entire school year. We'll cover some of these things like global warming, pollution, loss of biodiversity, environmental injustice, and so on. This particular program, the Environmental Fridays, is again designed to bring awareness and enlightenment. And hopefully out of this in awareness and enlightenment, we can come up with creative solutions for problems that exist in the environment and do something about it, take action to help keep our environment healthy. So at this point, we will now hear from Jordan.
Thank you. Okay, so Dr. Jason Claiborne is an assistant professor in biology at Miami-Dade College. His passions are education and research and conservation and sustainability. His professional life goals are to understand and preserve the entomological and botanical world, engage local communities through service learning, inquiry-based activities, and empower people to become citizen scientists. By doing so, we can enrich local biodiversity in neighborhoods, parks, and natural areas. We live in a time where experimental learning and stories about different species matter, because how we feel about and connect with these species will determine their survival in the present and future.
Good morning. Are you able to see the slide on the screen?
Yes, it's perfect. It's clear.
All right. So thank you, Jordan, for introducing me. And thank you, Dr. Murray, for inviting me to speak to the audience today. Hopefully at the end of this presentation, I can motivate each and every one of you to start a butterfly garden in your backyard, because often that's the first step to increase in biodiversity, not only in your yard, but also in your community. Mm. And so I'm gonna add a little twist and talk about how virtual gaming can actually enrich our knowledge about the worlds around us, locally and globally. So let's start with a test, but this is a fun test because identification matters. So when you go outside, you know, you might see a butterfly, but can you step up to the next level and identify the species? So I guess we can look at the chat or if you're able to annotate on the slide, which one is the monarch butterfly? Is it A, is it B, is it C, or is it D? What do you think?
Wow. I would probably go with either B or C, and then maybe B? The darker color one.
So I'm only going to give you only, this is a multiple choice question with only one answer.
Yeah, so B.
What is your final answer?
Final answer B.
I feel like it would be C for some reason, but also D has the Where's Waldo thing in it, so that's making me curious about it.
Yeah.
All right, so the Waldo is a distraction. I kind of throw little things like that into my presentations. However, Jordan, your first guess was correct. It is C. So C is the true monarch butterfly, and the other three mimic the monarch, or we could argue that the monarch mimics the other three.
Huh.
So A is called the queen butterfly, B is the viceroy butterfly, C is the monarch, and D is the, oh my goodness, sorry, I didn't trick myself. A is the soldier, B is the viceroy, C is the monarch, and D is the queen.
Okay.
And so if one of these species was endangered while the other ones were common, it would be important to figure out the correct species so that we could figure out how to improve this population and prevent extinction. All right.
So they, can I ask a question?
Yes.
I'm pretty curious. So they are all related. Are they all in the same family?
So A, D, and C, the queen, the soldier, queen, and monarch are actually closely related to each other to the point that they even feed on, the caterpillars are similar, and they feed on the same host plants, which I'll talk a little bit about more about later.
Okay.
B is somewhat related, but more distantly related.
Okay.
But it still looks like the other three, so that birds can recognize them as something that you don't want to eat. And so you have that benefit where they all look alike and they can all avoid the same predators.
I see. Okay.
All right. So a little bit about me, and I'll keep it short. I've always had a fascination for the outdoors, in particular wildlife. I kind of wanted to be a marine biologist when I was younger. And then when I was an undergrad, I actually majored in marine biology, but then I changed it to biology. And it was because of orcas. So if you look at the slide, when I was a little kid, I would go to SeaWorld in Cleveland, Ohio. Mm-hmm. And in this picture, you can see that I'm learning about krill. They're not at the bottom of the food chain, but they're right above phytoplankton. And the orcas depend on the fish and seals and penguins that eat the krill because the orcas themselves eat the seals. Mm-hmm. However, when I started my PhD research, I transitioned over to butterflies. In particular, insects like or predators that go after the caterpillars and stuff. So the butterfly that you see on this slide is actually considered one of the rarest butterflies in the United States, along with habitat loss being a big factor. Predation is another factor where the predators could literally eat this butterfly to extinction. So I investigated the predator-prey roles in this habitat. So after that, I passed my, I completed my dissertation and I became a doctor in biological sciences.
Mm-hmm.
So my colleague, I would like to acknowledge him too, because I know a lot about the biology and I know a lot about the ecology of the butterfly and forest environment and stuff. And so I feed that information to my colleague, Dr. De Lamar. We both graduated from FIU, Florida International University, which is in Miami. And he is now a computer engineer and works for the Dan Marino Foundation in Kansas City, Missouri. Mm-hmm. Or Kansas City, yeah, let's say Missouri. And so we have this cross collaboration where I give him the information about the butterflies and the plants and the ecosystem. Show him like, this is what they look like, this is how they behave. And so then he's able to take that information, turn it into code, which leads to the construction of a video game, which we continue to improve as we get more knowledge about virtual reality and then also about the wildlife. So I just want to acknowledge him and acknowledge and highlight the fact that we as people are social creatures by nature. And so we often don't do research in isolation. Mm-hmm. You want to make sure that you have allies who can help you when the times get hard, and also people who have different background knowledge, because they can actually help build you and make you a stronger scientist and often a stronger person. You don't learn anything if you don't make mistakes. And believe me, I've made a lot of mistakes as I've become a better scientist and a better person, hopefully.
Yes.
All right, so another test. And I do this to my students in class. And so by the end of the semester, the authors are much, much better at identifying the local wildlife. So I don't know how I'm going to do this, but let's just start. We'll pick a couple. All right. What is number 19? Can you give me the insect group? What would you call number 19? I don't need to know the species, but what group does it belong to? What do you think?
A fly.
All right. So you say it's a fly. All right. I'm not going to give you the answer until the end.
Okay.
All right. Let's go to, let's skip to number 22. What about number 22?
Oh, that's.
Is it a wasp?
Yeah, that's a wasp.
Okay. Yeah, so you're saying wasp. All right. What about number 24? What is number 24?
It kind of looks like a firefly a little bit, but I don't know.
And fireflies belong to which group? What do you think?
Diptera.
Okay. And let's end. Hold on a second.
Oh, Len said diptera.
Diptera.
Okay. All right. And what about number 25?
So that was just
one
person.
I believe that's another
bee.
All right.
So that's a honeybee. Mm-hmm.
So let's look for the answers. One second. All right. So here we go. 19 is a fly. That's actually a type of hoverfly that mimics a bee. 22 is a wasp. And 24 is a beetle. You said firefly. Fireflies are beetles. And then 25 is a bee. So just with this skill set, being able to distinguish, you know, between a fly and a bee matters, right? Because if we want to, let's say, improve the number, or if we want to increase the number of bee pollinators in our yard, you need to find out if that insect in your yard is a bee or a fly.
Mm-hmm.
And so identification matters. That's the thing that I'm going to be centering around today. Identifying, is this what you think it is?
Okay.
And so here are just the names in Spanish. Living in Miami, we have a very large Caribbean population. So I try to cater to all audiences.
Ooh.
So the next thing is, okay, we know that it's a butterfly, right? But is it really a butterfly? You have to look at the antennae. So if you see something that has feathery antennae or straight antennae, it's actually a moth, not a butterfly. If you see something that has club antennae, now that's a butterfly. But you might see something that has hooks. Let me get a screen. Hook antenna. That's actually a skipper. Now, they're all related to each other, but they're still different groups. They have different behaviors and often come out at different times. Moths tend to come out at night. Butterflies and skippers come out during the day. And they all, moths make cocoons. And butterflies and skippers make what's called a chrysalis. So that is a cocoon that's naked. Basically, moths put extra material around their chrysalis for added protection. So you know what's going to come next, right? So make sure you look at this slide because another test comes up. Okay. So let's start with A. What do you think? Is A a butterfly, a moth, or a skipper? A.
Butterfly.
Butterfly.
You are correct. That is a butterfly. Let's go to B. Is that a butterfly, moth, or skipper?
Moth.
You're correct. C. C is two of them. Is that a butterfly, moth, or skipper?
Oh, wow.
Moth. Moth.
That is actually a moth. That is correct. You see the antennae are straight. What about D? Is that a butterfly moth or skipper?
Yeah, that's a skipper, definitely.
Yes, you see the hook. And then E. What is E?
Looks like a skipper.
That is another skipper.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Now, I do want to highlight that A and E and possibly C are actually found in the Caribbean, too. E in particular is called the mangrove skipper. So whether you're in Trinidad and Tobago, Cuba, or the Florida Keys, you're going to actually see this skipper flying around. You just need to go to areas that have red mangroves. A is called the white peacock, and that's actually very, very common, not only in Florida, but also in the Caribbean. Every Caribbean island that I've been to, Turks and Caicos, Cuba, Trinidad, Tobago, Puerto Rico, you will see that butterfly. There'll be slight color changes, but these butterflies are relatively common. And if you find their host plant, that's what they lay their eggs on, you'll also see this butterfly.
Hmm.
So why am I even talking about this? You know, butterflies, right? Well, invertebrates in general, these are animals without backbones, and insects in particular, some of them are not doing very well. To the point that it might become problematic when growing certain types of food. Regarding the insects that we should be concerned about, from a use, what use does it have for people? We should be very concerned about pollinators, because a lot of the food that you eat, if it produces a fruit, let's say mangoes, oranges, limes, tomatoes, all of those plants require pollinators. Now, some have said, you know, well, we can still eat things that are wind pollinated, right? But that would leave us with just, you would have bread that you could add rice to and maybe supplement it with a little bit of, I don't know, potatoes or something like that. So we would lose a lot of those bright, colorful fruits, from peppers to mangoes to tomatoes. They all depend on pollinators. Otherwise, we would have to hire people to stick Q-tips into flowers and pollinate them ourselves. These insects do that for free.
Yeah.
And so to highlight my butterfly, I'm going to focus on the Florida Keys, because in South Florida, we actually have 4 butterflies that are federally listed as endangered, with some of them that probably will disappear within the next 20 or 30 years. My particular butterfly is the Shell Swallowtail, and it's only found in the North Florida Keys, if you look at the map to the right. But what's really interesting is that people will send me emails and say, hey, I have this in my backyard. And what is happening is that they're confusing the Shouse with the giant swallowtail, which is right here. I'm going to get the pen going. And it's because they look very similar to each other. We even have another one called the Bahama swallowtail, which occasionally flies around in the Florida Keys, and it also looks similar to the Shouse. So if you can identify the Shouse in great detail, or if we can help improve those skills, we can figure out where this butterfly is flying around in the Keys. The other butterfly that has species that look similar to it is the Miami Blue. This one, I'm actually really concerned that it might disappear within a couple of decades, because it's only thriving in some of the most inhospitable like patches of islands out past Key West. And if a hurricane comes in, like a really bad one, it could literally just wipe this butterfly off the map, like literally just destroy the whole island. And they've tried to increase the numbers on other patches of or other islands, and it's not recovering. So people often will submit emails, I have this in my backyard, but that's because they see these two butterflies, which are actually pretty common, the Cassius and Serranus blue. And then finally, we have the Bartrams and the Florida leafwing. These are in our famous Everglades National Park. But one of the reasons why they're not doing well is because they need fire. So some of these ecosystems actually need fires every 1 to 5 years. And if the fire is removed, it changes the entire ecosystem, and then those butterflies can't survive. So these are just four of the many other insect species that are declining. But if we learn how to identify them and protect them, we can actually protect a lot of other insects in particular that live in these same ecosystems. So I believe that butterflies are the ambassadors for insect education and conservation. And so in the end, let me move this 1 second. In the end, we only conserve what we love. We will only love what we understand, and we will only understand what we are taught. So this highlights the importance of education and teachers and just this peer-to-peer conversation about what's going on in the world and how things work. And this quote was by a Senegalese poet, Baba Diom. This is a very powerful quote that I use all the time for a lot of my presentations. And so what we want to do with our VR, virtual reality, is bridge this intention behavior gap. We want to educate you about what's going on in the world, and then we want you to do something about it. So education leading to action. So why virtual reality? Well, you can explore different places, impossible, difficult to access. I remember when I was in Trinidad and Tobago, and I listened to this graduate student talk about how difficult it was for him to travel to locations to study vampire bats, and how, you know, he'd have to, you know, drive over roads that were just, you know, difficult to cross. So maybe instead of bringing people out to see these vampire bats, you could create a world where you see it virtually, right? He has access to find these bats and stuff, but not everybody has what he has. And so we could build that for people. It provides a safe environment. So if you didn't know, the Florida Keys in the forest has a lot of mosquitoes, a lot, and it's hot. And so not everybody is gonna wanna deal with that. So you can go and visit these forests, but not have to deal with the mosquitoes. And then of course, there's that active learning. You are engaging with the creatures in this VR world and learning while you do it. This is a supplemental way to educate people, and you can do it in the classroom or you can do it as some kind of game. So for those of you who are looking to go to medical school or dental school, you might work with a cadaver virtually. So a cadaver is a dead human body. You do that virtually before you actually work with a real one. So that way you get more training that way. If you're a dentist, you could virtually extract, you know, teeth out of a person before you do the real thing, right? I mean, The more practice, the better. You know, you don't want to traumatize a person because you extract the tooth the wrong way. So you can gain these skills virtually. So remember, proper name and identification, please. You know, you see this butterfly and it's flying in your yard. So which one is federally endangered? That's C, the shallow swallowtail butterfly. Which one is common in your backyard? That's A, the giant swallowtail. And then which one is a rare stray from the Caribbean? That's B. So we can build all of this into our virtual world to help you recognize these species in a fun, interactive kind of way. And so how does this apply to the real world? So every year from April until June, volunteers go into the Florida Keys to survey this butterfly. We're trying to track the numbers. And so you need to make sure that you can identify the correct one, because all three species exist in the same habitat. Mm. And so if you see at the bottom, we can improve the identification skills of these butterflies and other wildlife through this virtual reality gaming experience. So that way people who are new to surveying the butterfly can practice virtually and then go into the forest and identify it. And of course, this is just cool for kids, you know. Mm-hmm. I could just lecture to you the entire time, or I could give you instructions and say, all right, play the game, try to beat the game. By them beating the game, they have to know how to identify the butterflies. So they're going to come out of the game knowing more about the butterflies, where they live, and how to find them. So here are just two examples. We have a desktop version, and we have a VR, the version that you can put into your headset. The desktop is readily available now, which you should be able to access with this QR code, but I also have a link in a later slide. And here is what the VR version looks like, and you're picking up things. You have to, in this case, he picked up the butterfly, and then he has to answer the question. And so that was correct. So if you want to read the paper that we published about the game, that's also here. And so once again, let me highlight the problem so that we can transition to the solution. And this applies not just to butterflies, but to a lot of the species out there in the world. This applies to tigers. This applies to, the Puerto Rican parrot. This applies to the pine rockland's trapdoor spider, which is rare in South Florida. Think of an animal that is decreasing or declining. And a lot of it has to do with the number one issue is habitat loss. So a lot of species are losing their habitat. And for insects, pesticides. Pesticides are designed to kill insects as pests, right? But sometimes too much of it can actually kill the insects that you're not targeting. So when you combine habitat loss with pesticide overuse, that leads to insect and butterfly declines. Another big issue in South Florida are houses. This house is beautiful. Would you want to live there? Yes, maybe. I would love to live there. All right. But this house is, in regards to plant life, the botanical world, it's a desert. Most of these plants are non-native. They're from other parts of the world. And there's not much plant diversity and structural complexity. So let me say it again. There is a lack of plant diversity and structural complexity. Mm-hmm. It's kind of barren. And a lot of our yards look like this. I don't know if you know, but in the past, people used to actually use their yards to grow food. Now we just have grass on it. We pay to water it, and we pay to add fertilizer to it, and you don't get any potatoes out of it, or pumpkin, or squash. You're literally paying money to keep up a look. Mm-hmm. So I would argue that each and all of, if you have a yard like this, at least maybe start with 10% and convert it into something that you can get value out of. That is your space, right? Let's turn it into something that you can maybe eat. You can even sell some of the fruit. People do that in Miami all the time. They sell their mangoes. They sell their avocados, you know? So, and this is a yard, another typical yard in Miami. This is even worse. Like, you have an oak tree, and this plant is definitely not native. And then you have this grass. I mean, look at that. It's just grass. all right, if you're going to play soccer or football, baseball, fine. But if you don't do any of that stuff, let's use that yard for something.
Mm-hmm.
And so what you can do, let me erase the ink. All right. And what you can do is add structural complexity to your yard and increase the plant diversity. Those two things will increase the wildlife, which can actually present that it can lead to you feeling better. Imagine, you know, you've had a long day at school, right? You're taking, you know, history, and you have a history test and an algebra test, and, you know, the drive home was rough, and you go home and you get to hear birds chirping. You see a couple of butterflies flying around your yard. That actually can reduce the stress that might have built up in your body. There are plenty of studies that I can show later that suggest that nature can be therapeutic, especially if you live in a stressful environment and stuff. So you work or you're in school, and then you take a walk into the forest for like 30 minutes, you're gonna come out feeling a little bit better. Well, you can create this same forest in your backyard by just increasing the types of plants, mostly native, and making sure they're at different heights. So some trees, some shrubs, some ferns, all that kind of stuff.
Mm.
And so with this image to the right, just increasing the amount of plant diversity can actually increase the amount of other animals that might visit your yard, focusing mainly on birds and butterflies. But if you're into amphibians, bees, they might come to your yard too. And so we can create these corridors and sanctuaries. You can literally turn butterfly gardens into a corridor, or if all of your neighbors on your block have butterfly gardens, it can become a sanctuary for these species that they can actually increase their population. And I want to let you know that this is super infectious, in that if people see that you have a nice butterfly garden with a lot of butterflies, they might say, I want that too. And that's what we're trying to get people to do. It's one of my goals in Miami is to try to maximize the amount of butterfly gardens in every household throughout Miami. And so in particular, if you look at the Florida dusky wing to the right, this is a skipper that is also in peril, so on the verge of extinction. And so you could add locust berry, which is at the bottom. If we increase the amount of locust berry that's next to the natural preserves where it does exist, we could expand or extend the habitat for this dusky. So what do I want to do with the virtual reality game? It's a means to an end. One, I want to reverse extinction of experience. I want you all to experience the nature, right? Then you're going to connect more to it. I want to bridge the intention behavior gap. What does that mean? That means that you learn something and then you do something about it, right?
Mm-hmm.
You learn that some of these butterflies are declining, so you build a butterfly garden to help out the population. I want to increase wildlife habitat. Just build more butterfly gardens. And of course, let's be inclusive to all communities, the disabled, the elderly, and in the incarcerated. I actually volunteer. My mother works at a detention center in Cleveland, Ohio. And every time I go and visit her, I go to the detention center, talk to the kids, of course, about STEM, math, and science. But we also play games. You know, we play these VR games and stuff. So this is accessible to people from all around the world. I've been to Trinidad and Tobago. I've had the opportunity to do that, but not everybody can do that. So we could create a rainforest that represents Trinidad and Tobago, and then people could play the game and see, you know, what kind of plants and animals live in, you know, the rainforest of Trinidad and Tobago. In particular, I still have not seen the army ants. I know there are army ants in Trinidad, and you know, I could actually build that into the game so that people could see how cool these ants are, right? Because I'm going to tell you right now, you can't just walk into a rainforest in Trinidad and find and be like, oh, there they go. No, they are very difficult to find. Yeah, believe me, I've been trying to find those army ants for a very long time.
Okay.
Yeah. So another test, you just saw the Florida Dusky Wing. Remember, identification matters. So can you identify the Florida Dusky Wing? Which one is it? A, B, or C? Were you paying attention? Because all three exist in the same habitat, and only one of them is on the verge of extinction. So what do you think? A, B, or C?
I don't know.
Is it C?
All right, so you say C?
I'm unsure, but yeah.
So it's actually B, but a lot of people confuse it with C. So that's a really good guess. And do you see? So if we were to do a study and try to estimate the size of this population and we mix B and C together, then we might actually think that the population is larger than what it really is. So how do you tell the difference? This is kind of crazy. Basically, this is the Horus Dusky Wing, and you look for these three dots on the fore wing.
Oh, wow.
Right? the Florida Dusky Wing only has three in that section.
Wow, yeah.
So let me go back real quick so you can see. And so if you look here, it has the three. So that's what I look for.
Okay.
So this would be like if you're playing a video game and you know, this would be the final boss, in the video game. So as we wrap up, I'm going to connect this to the Caribbean, of course. And why? The Caribbean islands, all of them, are biological hotspots. What does that mean? There's a lot of biodiversity there, which needs to be protected. And so here, you know, I'm in South Florida, but that has a lot of species that spill over from the Caribbean islands. And in particular, my butterfly only exists in the Florida Keys, but does it? There are actually subspecies. So I'm not going to get into whether subspecies are different species, but let's look at the other closely, very, very, very closely related shelf swallowtails that live in Cuba, the Turks and Caicos, the Dominican Republic and Puerto Rico, and then, of course, like I said, the Bahamas, in particular, Andros Island. And so did you know that the populations in of all of these other islands are much higher than in the Florida Keys? So there is a Caribbean connection because we could actually study what's going on in the Caribbean. Why are they doing much better than in the Florida Keys? Get that information and then try to better manage the populations in the Florida Keys. So in this case, the Caribbean is a great area. Presents an opportunity to prevent extinctions in the Florida Keys. And so what do you value? You know, like, why do we really care? I talked about pollinators and plants. Well, it's the ecosystem services. In particular for the butterflies, there's that spiritualness, the aesthetics. So, you know, it's pretty. It can be enriching. So I would argue that the butterflies present that. Of course, some of them are pollinators, but they also provide food for other animals that we might like, such as birds. So I'm going to draw this triangle and kind of highlight, that's not a triangle. Let me try again. Oh my goodness. That's a horrible triangle. All right. Okay. All right. I can do this. I can do this.
You could do it. You could do it.
All right. So what is one value? Well, one is called intrinsic, but I'm not going to use the word, there's the intrinsic value, but I'm just going to say exist.
Hmm.
The butterfly just has the right to exist, because who are we to come in and cause it to go extinct, right? Mm-hmm. So that's one value. Another value is aesthetics, but I'm just going to use the word beauty.
Mm-hmm.
It's beautiful. Mm-hmm. And did you know that humans value things that are beautiful? Imagine a diamond. Diamonds actually they're just carbon, right? But people will pay thousands, if not tens of thousands of dollars for a diamond on a ring, because it's beautiful.
Beautiful.
All right, and then the other one is utilitarian, mm-hmm. but I'll use another word, it's usefulness. Mm-hmm. So it's useful. Oh my goodness. That's supposed to say useful. And so remember I mentioned pollinator services, mm-hmm. that is useful to people. Otherwise we'd have to pay people to do something that insects would do for free. So these are, I call it the triangle of values, and often we're more likely to protect things because of beauty and then its usefulness. But others argue that we should not just cause extinctions. They have the right to exist too. Mm-hmm. So this all depends on which species are going to be winners and losers. There's a lot more money that goes into the conservation of pandas and elephants than will go into the hellbender salamander or the desert pupfish. Which lives in like Arizona. The salamander is like Kentucky, West Virginia, stuff like that, because we don't know much about them. They're not as charismatic. And so butterflies are charismatic, and we can use the butterflies to help other species.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'm not going to play the video.
Okay.
I mean, what's my time? This is like
how long is the video?
It's like 2 minutes or...
Oh, yeah, play the video. Play the video.
All right. 2 minutes. So here's the video of the game. And if you want to access the desktop, you can use this link right here.
Okay.
Or you can do the QR code. If you want the VR version, you have to send me an email, because I have to give you the package and the instructions on how to upload it to your VR headset, which is through Oculus, by the way. So this is what you would do in the game. And then you have to identify, you get a badge.
Oh.
And you definitely need to read the signs about the plants, because you're only going to find certain butterflies around their host plants, which is where they lay their eggs. Take a picture of it. All right. And then you have to answer another question. So thank you for your attention. And you can reach me. My email is right here at the bottom. And if you have time, check out my website, which is just jasonclayborn.com is my name. Mm-hmm. And if you want, you can follow me on Instagram and Twitter. I post pictures on Instagram. I vaguely interact on Twitter. I'm usually just using Twitter to get information about what's going on in the science world.
Mm-hmm.
So thank you for the opportunity to speak to you all.
Oh,
build a butterfly garden if you can.
yes. Thank you so very much. So, Jordan, do you want to lead off with questions?
So you helped in designing that, or you helped with your associate? The game?
Yeah, so I mean, you know, he's the computer scientist, so yeah. He's writing the code and, you know, making sure that things work. He actually has to see the butterflies in the picture on the right, or the image. He has to actually scan that onto a virtual model. So I have to give him those images, and then he scans it. So we work in tandem. Then he'll build the plant, and I'll tell him like, oh, put the mangrove by the water, and then you want to put, let's say, an oak tree, put that in the interior. So I help like design the layout of the game. I do the questions and usually edit the content and stuff like that.
I think that's really cool, because when you showed the video, I didn't realize how like interactive it was and identifying.
Oh, the game is not easy. And we have what's called the Red House, which is where we, in order to like fully pass the game, so you answer all the questions, then you go to the Red House and we introduce like other species that weren't even in the game to see if you fully recognize, if you can distinguish between, you know, the Shouse and then all those other Caribbean Shouses too. But that's supposed to be fun. I mean, we want to make sure that you can identify these species from the other species that exist.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So I have questions too. And I, you know, we could circle back again to Jordan if you have more. So going all the way back, why did you transition from marine to butterflies? You said you made the transition, but you didn't really, I can't recall you saying why.
All right, so I mean, I'm gonna be completely honest with everybody, especially since I'm talking to the youth.
Okay.
So don't take this, but I mean, in regards to opportunities, there are more opportunities in biology than in marine bio. Now, if your passion is marine biology, please go ahead and do it. I'm not discouraging you from that. But as a biology major, you know, for an undergrad, I can go and study ants and cheetahs and butterflies, or I can become a doctor, you know, or a dentist, a physician's assistant. You know, biology is a broader topic. The other thing is, I mean, when you're making decisions about going to school and which programs you want to invest in, remember it is an investment, and you are going to expect to get paid for your work in the future. Mm-hmm. And so marine science is super competitive, but they also, depending on whether you become a professor or not, you might not make as much money. So that can become a problem, because and your jobs might not be permanent before they become permanent. So the question is, how many years of postdocs or internships or research assistantships are you willing to do before it's like, all right, I'm 35 years old, I need a permanent job with healthcare, right? Mm-hmm. And so in biology, I can do both. In biology, you have the best of both worlds. I can dip into marine science, mm-hmm. but I still have that foundation of the biological sciences. Mm-hmm. So that's the way I looked at it. You know, I wanted flexibility just in case one thing didn't work out for me.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah.
Very good. Very good.
Now, I just want to highlight, nothing's wrong with marine biology. You know, we need more marine biologists and stuff, mm-hmm. but, you know, you can major in biology and still do marine bio research later on.
Right. Anybody else has questions? I have more, but I don't want to, you know, take up everything. Anybody else? No, I was speaking with a friend that lives in Tobago. Mm-hmm. And she was telling me that she hasn't seen a butterfly in a long, long time. Have you got a sense of what's going on? Have you done a lot of fieldwork over there too?
So actually, I do not.
Okay.
Most of my research in the Caribbean has actually been in Cuba, the Dominican Republic, Turks and Caicos, and in Puerto Rico, with the bulk of it being in Puerto Rico.
Okay.
So that's actually kind of concerning. And
It is.
Yeah. Because even the common butterflies should still be there. So I think that's actually an opportunity.
It is.
Where you could have high schools, middle schools, you know, maybe go out and survey. you know, survey different parts of Tobago and then build, you know, track the species that they see every year and then the abundance, and you just build onto it year after year after year. And that could be a part of the curricula in regards to whatever you have to learn in school, you know, identification of things, the scientific method, right? Cause and effect. All of these are like kind of base things that you must learn in school.
Right, right.
So that's actually an opportunity.
It is a great opportunity. Len?
Yes, I have a comment and then a question. Jason, I'm actually a Tobagonian, so that is interesting. I have heard that the high use of insecticides to kill mosquitoes, the aerosol insecticide that they drive around and spray, has been responsible for eliminating a lot of the butterflies and other insects. I don't know how true that is, but I've made that observation myself, that whenever I return, I don't see the number of butterflies that I used to see as a child growing up on the island. But my question, Jason, you talked about the greenery, the grass and lawns and so on in homes, and suggested some changes, which I think are quite appropriate. However, a lot of these homes are controlled by homeowners associations, which mandate certain kind of grass, kind of trees, the entire quality, unless you enclose the back and do something in the backyard. There are a lot of restrictions to the front yards and a lot of requirements for maintaining lawns and so on. How do we combat that?
I mean, that's more of a... Because Miami is very similar, where people will... I mean, we have... I'm just giving quickly. Not only is it a plant issue, but it's some HOAs will not allow you to have solar panels on your roof unless you can put it in the back. And it's like, but, you know, we want to reduce our energy bill. So... A way is, you know, through organizations. I don't know if you could just educate them, you know, like bring in a butterfly expert or an expert on plant diversity, you know, a botanist, and then just have them have a meeting. They could just, you know, give an interactive, engaging, fun presentation with the HOA leaders and say, look, here are some cool alternatives. These are pretty plants that are native that, you could grow fruits and eat and or, you know, provide habitat for some of these wildlife. It all depends on personality, right? The other thing is you would have to get the community to kind of organize against them and maybe vote them out. But then you're going to have to convince the majority in that neighborhood that this is worth doing, right? So that would be education and persuasion. And that's pretty much how politics work, right?
Right.
You have an idea, it might be good, but then you have to convince everybody that your idea is good. I would suggest that, you know, try to fluff this up, you know, show the values, say like, what do you value? And go from there. Education and persuasion. Some people are not gonna move, but if you can get the majority to move, that leads to change. That's a good question. It's really hard.
Yeah, it's hard, yeah. You have to be an activist. You have to get involved in the political process. You have to do education and persuasion, as you said, definitely.
But I want to add, but the one thing about as an activist, that can be inflammatory, like that word. You have to kind of meet them where they are and not like, what are you doing? You should, you know, you got to just get to be like, hey, let's work together. This is so cool. Look at this butterfly. It uses this plant.
Right.
And it may work and it may not work, but usually you have to meet them where they are.
Yeah, I think you have a personality that's coming through that people would, you know, see as non-confrontational and of having them perceive this as valuable and fun at the same time. And I think that's the approach. That's a great approach.
I mean, this is growth, by the way. I've learned from past mistakes. Okay. I continue to grow. In South Florida, I mean, I don't want to really get into the politics, but it's a different mindset. In South Florida, in Miami in particular, our economy is based on tourism and business, and then, of course, development. So, like, building houses. A lot of money is put in, a lot of money is generated from building houses, and often they build these houses in protected in areas that need protection, right? Mm-hmm. So I that's a battle that I can't win. But what I can try to do is convince these developers to at least plant native plants, focusing mainly on native plants that attract a lot of pollinators and stuff. You know, so I meet them where they are.
Yeah. Hey, Jordan, you have any other questions?
Well, I was just going to make a comment. I actually have two. I was thinking about it before. I think if you just like show to them that it can be pretty and look professional still, Homeowners Association, I think that is a big part. Because I think when people think of it, they may think it will be trashy looking or somewhat, because there's just a lot of plants. But if you can show them that there are pretty plants and that it can also attract pretty butterflies, and that'll be helpful. But I also was curious what your yard would look like.
My yard is a jungle. You were talking about
the houses, and I was like, well, what does yours look like?
That's actually a really good question. I should have put pictures up. But my yard is, my yard is where the butterflies come and hang out and then go into my neighbor's yard. And and they notice when I might cut down a plant, like a bush, and that butterfly is no longer there. They're like, hey, the black butterfly with the yellow on it is not flying around. What happened? I had to change the plant. In my yard is a zoo, but it's managed. It's manageable, right? HOA will come in and say, cut them out. But then I give plants to my neighbors to kind of expand that sanctuary for them. I do want to highlight one thing though before I forget, and Jordan talked about this. You asked me a question about the computer science side of this. I want to argue to all of the youth out there, you know, computer science alone is great, but a lot of the research that we do now involves computer science. So you know, whether you become an accountant, a doctor, you do construction, whatever, knowing a little bit of coding and maybe, you know, minoring in computer science is going to help whatever you do. It's a skill set that we kind of need now. So learning C++ or HTML, don't be afraid of it. You know, this is, and as I see the world changing, the science that I recognized when I was an undergrad is not the science nowadays. There is it's machine learning algorithms to count the number of elephants in an ecosystem. It's using artificial intelligence to see, you know, where the birds are migrating at night. All of this is, you know, it's putting radio transmitters on sharks and then using satellite data to figure out where these sharks are migrating. So you love sharks, but now you have to know how, understand how to process all that big data that's coming from the satellite, right? And then the engineering, building that radio transmitter to put it on the shark so that it doesn't break. So all of these are actually embedded in science. That technology and science literally are kind of like together. So either you could do it on your own or you collaborate with people, you collaborate with other engineers. So do not stray away from computer science. If you can take a course in high school or in undergrad, take it.
So Jordan, isn't that what you do at IBM
Quantum? Yeah, I was thinking about that. There's a lot of applications that you can do with the quantum computing, and that is something that is going to have a bigger demand because they're faster and better computers, and that you can, it's not just this computer-based field, like it can be applied across multiple fields. It can be a chemical, a biological field, medical. So that, there's a demand in that, and people think that it may just be computer-based, but no, a lot of computing and computer science can be applied across a number of different fields.
So I know you said, Jordan, that you don't haven't decided fully on what you will do in college, but I'm assuming it's going to involve computers in some way, application, combining computers and science or something?
It's just a hobby. It's not really something I took just a regular programming class last year, and I think it's interesting, but the quantum computing is a lot more math, a lot more physics-based computing. But I think, I did think for a while I was going to do like environmental engineering, but I think it's too much changing and just trying to work way around it and not necessarily like addressing the problem and finding more math.
So the wizards, it's using your technology to deal with climate change versus, yeah. So I believe it's a battle. It's basically wizards versus prophets. The prophets are the scientists that are saying, hey, this is bad. We need to change the way we farm or use fossil fuels. And the wizards are like, oh, well, we could just build technology to deal with that, you know, intensive farming.
And cause more problems.
Yeah, I mean, a little bit of both, right? But yeah, I think it's a fun debate. I love to hear ideas from the wizards, the engineers, and then the prophets, you know, the scientists. It's interesting stuff if you're into environmental technology. So, I mean, I want to highlight, like, there is going to be a conversation about putting sulfur or sulfates, like aerosols into the air to kind of cool the planet temporarily. And it's interesting, but the problem is, like, if we don't drastically reduce the greenhouse gases, once that stuff wears off, then our planet's going to get, like, really hot.
Yeah.
But that's what a wizard would think, an engineer.
I have never heard the framing and the expression prophets versus wizards. That's another thing I learned today in the last few minutes. So that's something that people talk about in those fields, like wizards and prophets?
I mean, yeah. So, I mean, a prophet is going to be like a scientist or anybody, somebody who is documenting this change.
Yeah.
And then saying like, all right, so if we continue to use more land to grow corn and soybeans, then this animal is going to go extinct. So we should probably stop destroying the habitat, right?
Uh-huh.
While a wizard would come in and say, well, maybe we could build artificial habitats for this animal while we still farm, you know.
Yeah.
Maybe if it does go extinct, we could genetically engineer it, you know, once things change. So, you know, what you could do is you could build artificial land and then also reduce the amount of land using, you know, for farming. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, it's just a fun conversation. I mean, remember, not everybody's a wizard or a prophet. Usually it's a spectrum for one end to the other.
Well, Professor, that was really good presentation. And I could see this presentation working at all educational levels, really. It's a powerful tool that you're giving us here that could be applied not only to butterflies, but across the spectrum, as well as, you know, elementary students, high school students, college students. I wish you all the best, man. This is a powerful tool that you're working on here.
Well, thank you. I appreciate it. And once again, thank you for the opportunity to talk to everybody. Thank you, Jordan, for introducing me. And thank you, Dr. Murray, for bringing me into this forum to talk to people about butterfly conservation, at least for this presentation, and the use of virtual reality.
Yes, we'll have you back. That's for sure. And check out Tobago.
Yes.
That's the research we are waiting to happen.
Okay.
Yeah.
I try to get the Tobago because I heard the seafood curry there is delicious. and I just couldn't get there. But I do want to go, and I definitely want to get the seafood curry while I'm there.
And make sure you visit this beach behind me here.
All right. What's the name of the beach?
That is Storby.
Storby.
Okay.
That's right. near Crown Point, near the airport.
All right. Will do.
And you guys could talk offline some more too, because this is really, like Len was saying, an opportunity to you were saying too, Professor Claiborne, an opportunity to like have the students in Tobago get involved in this, in this venture, and learn, incorporate it into their education, computing, the science. It's a great opportunity, actually.
All right. I mean, I'll stick around if you want, so we can chat for a little bit.
All right. Okay. So I'll formally close it off, stop the recording and stuff. And again, thank you so much to Jordan, to Professor Claiborne, and to all of us here on this session of Environmental Fridays. It is personal. Thank you.